Atheist Nomads, episode 145, interview with Tom Meacham on secular mental health.
The podcast you're about to listen to includes cursing and talking about hoo-haws. Please be advised.
We are the Atheist Nomads, bringing you history, science, politics, religion, and interviews with leaders in the atheist community. Not all those who wander are lost. Welcome to another episode of Atheist Nomads. I am Dustin. Joining me as always is Wesley.
Hello, everybody. Why is there porn on my walls? I'm just joking. Or am I?
Yeah, if you have to ask, it's...
Yeah, and assuming we don't have any technical difficulties, this episode will also be available on YouTube, youtube.com/atheistnomads, or at least go onto YouTube and search for Atheist Nomads. The episode should be there. Before we introduce the guest, I do have a couple of things to bring up. First one is we have an app now. It has officially been released. It is available on iOS in the App Store and Android in the Google Play Market.
Yeah, so we got two apps.
That's right.
Fucking A.
And one of our listeners reached out to us to see if we could talk about the daughter of a coworker of his.
Yeah.
She has cancer in her eye. We're talking a very young, like 4 or 5 year old girl with eye cancer. The insurance isn't likely to cover much more or all that much of it. So they do have a GoFundMe to try to raise $20,000. That is probably not going to be enough to actually cover the bills. So please help out if you can. The link will be at the top of the show notes. This little girl needs help. And, you know, as I'm sure all of our listeners know, as the child of a cancer survivor, that is a topic that is very near and dear to my heart. And when it's a little kid with cancer, that's just, fuck. So, yes, if you can help, please do. And, yes, if you read the description on GoFundMe, there is religious language involved. This isn't our listener's daughter, but it is one of his coworkers, and we are better than... holding somebody's the parent's belief against the child that is sick. So yes, please do help. Again, the link will be in the show notes, and we will bring this up again at the very end. And so now on to our guest, even though really shouldn't have started off with a really somber topic like kids with cancer. But our guest
is gonna get a lot.
Depression is not the cheeriest topic.
Yes, okay, that's fair. Our guest today is Tom Meacham. He is a MD psychiatrist, and we're gonna be talking about mental health issues. So, Tom, welcome to Atheist Nomads.
Well, thank you very much. Happy to be here.
Yeah, I do remember that when we met face to face when I was in Tacoma, that had a wonderful chat with you. I don't remember all the details because I was completely shit-faced. Those of you who watched that live recording, this would have been about 6 hours later, and I'd probably had another 10 beers.
Oh, God.
Or more. yeah, that bartender was taking really good care of me.
Oh, yeah. They do a good job down at Doyle's.
Yeah. Yes.
So, yeah, moving on. So, do you actually treat a fair amount of secular or atheist patients, or?
Well, short answer, sure. I don't have any kind of practice like that. I actually work for a large organization, and I treat anyone who comes in my door. If I'm nice. they come in, sit down, I see them, and okay. So I get a little bit of all comers that way.
Yeah, I do recall what you mentioning what organization that was. You don't need to say that on the show if you don't want to.
Yeah, they don't. They actually want to make it very clear that I need to speak for myself, and I don't speak for the large organization. Yes. I work for. So really, I'd rather not. So there's no
but misunderstanding. The clientele that you see are definitely people with who need mental health services.
Oh yes, yeah. Very much so. lots of people with depression, post-traumatic stress disorder, substance. Well, the usual things you hear about mental illness.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a lot I don't see.
All right. Why did you get into being a psychiatrist?
Oh, wow. Now I got to reach way back with that. Started as a child, I think. No, realistically, I had an uncle who was a psychiatrist. And, he was a good role model. And, and I was like in high school, suddenly the books would show up in the household and I'd pick them up and read them and go, that's kind of cool stuff, And from there, and I followed one of my older brothers into med school. It just seemed like a path that a lot of people in the family took. And it was a good fit.
Ah, very nice.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm way too klutzy to be a surgeon. Let's just right. get real here.
I was gonna go with the question like, so you followed in the talkers, but I'm guessing he followed in the cutter. He followed in the cutters.
Yeah, he was my older brother. Yeah, no, he's something of a cutter. He's an interventional radiologist. So he sucks things out through straws. It's pretty impressive.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just going to leave that there.
it's a procedural field, yeah.
Sure.
All right. And do you have any kind of background with religion? Were you raised religious?
Oh, yeah, basically. Not crazy religious. I think, my parents made sure I grew up in a exposed to it I was even confirmed in the Episcopal Church, but it was a very staid, very Church of England like mm-hmm. organization. And at some point, and I was certainly raised to be a critical thinker. So I don't know, at some point, I remember being a kid and really wanting to believe, and you're praying and this and that. And it's just like after 6 or 8 months of it going, this ain't doing nothing. There's no there,
Mm-hmm.
Well, and then I go off and get a scientific education. And at some point I turn around and go, well, that was interesting, but let's get real here.
Well, and the whole Episcopal style though, it's like, I've been to a couple of Episcopal services and even an Episcopal funeral. And it's very much going through the motions of the tradition.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, our Episcopal priest was an old Air Force general.
Aww.
It was something to do with the missile program and nuclear weapons and whatever. And I think he got cancer and had a change of heart on all that. So it was Father Medeiros. And it's just very straightforward. Mm-hmm. It was no nonsense. He didn't. Although I went back many years later, same church, and I think it kind of went from high church to low church in the meantime, and the preacher was talking like this, and it's like, I gotta get out of here.
Oh, you
gotta
wow.
watch out when they pick up.
Yeah, it was like it's strange.
Wow. Okay,
that was in Florida. Yeah, but it's kind of, I think it tracked with the. The born again, stuff mm-hmm. happening during that era.
But yeah, going from Episcopal to atheist, that's not a huge jump.
No, not really. And truth be known, I have been known to join up with Unitarian churches, but ones that have a fair number of atheists, mm-hmm. the ones where the scientists like to hang out.
Oh, definitely. Well, you wouldn't get any judgment from us on that.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Why do Unitarians sing so badly, sing hymns so badly? They're reading ahead to see if they agree with the lyrics. Yeah. If you don't piss a Unitarian off, they'll burn a big wooden cross on your, pardon me, big wooden question mark on your lawn.
Like, my wife was.
I blew that joke, yeah.
My wife was raised going to a Unitarian right. church.
Exactly.
All right. So one thing that you definitely hear about from time to time is religion creeping up into the the whole mental health topics, like you know, so-called counselors who have some kind of a certificate from a Bible college and not necessarily any real training.
Right.
Why is that really a thing?
Well, the average, I'm sure all this varies from state to state because it's the states that regulate licensure and, yeah, and such. And then there's pastoral counseling, which blends into actual mental health. And then, you know, you'll get pastoral counselors who, in fact, are licensed therapists, social workers, psychologists, and so it's kind of buyer beware out there when you go to a therapist or even a psychiatrist. Ethically, they should be telling you if they're doing that. I mean, you know, if that's what you're looking for and what you want, and in fact is what a lot of people want, it's all well and good, but that's what you really need to know. You deserve to know that's what you're getting before you sign up.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, it's like a matter of degree. There's the every degree of how much religion do you want to put into it, you know. Mm-hmm. And now, going to medical school and medically, what psychiatrists do, and when the psychiatrists are they're the organization that comes up with this is how you make the diagnosis, and we used to be responsible for all the treatments and things, but that has over many decades things have stratified. You know, we do the biological treatments more than mm-hmm. the therapy. There are psychiatrists who still do psychotherapy, but you should, you know, in general, you're probably not going to go to a psychiatrist in modern times with insurance companies and things and not walk out with some sort of prescription, or likely to, or at least be evaluated for it. In terms of therapy, boy, where do you start?
Is it even
scientific? It should be. There are scientifically proven therapies, mm-hmm. and as a matter of fact, they tend to, you know, over time they aim for efficiency, you know, and it's driven by a lot of economics as well as the science. But so they're getting efficient at reducing symptoms. And they do look a lot different than they used to. I remember one psychiatry resident back in the day. I was in training in Dayton, Ohio, and he was doing studies showing that when people prayed for you, even if you didn't know you were being prayed for, you were more likely to get better.
Oh, wow.
I believe, yes, and those got published. And then they were later found to be fraudulent. Mm-hmm. go figure. At least some just like it were. I didn't actually check to see what his name was. And
oh, wow.
Yeah. So you kind of, you know, not just it. There's a constant incursion, just like everywhere else, towards religion mm-hmm. in treatment. And, of course, then you have the 12-step movement, which, you know, which has a lot of industry and government advocating, whether mm-hmm. they should or not, it's there. And the best I can tell, there is no clear boundary between the 12-step organizations and a church. You look at it all, you know, they've got their commandments, they've got their 12 steps, they've got their belief in God, they've got the pass the hat, it's all there, you know.
It really feels kind of cultish to me, though.
Well, it can be, and some more than others. Group. I'm coming from the South. I'm only recently to the Pacific Northwest, and I'm coming from the South to where 12-step groups are, you know, they'll tell you you have to believe in Jesus, not just the God as you understand them, which is the official way, mm-hmm. but Jesus proper. And if you don't, you can't possibly be sober. Now, I know some good atheist AA members who hang out there basically so that other people coming in who may have some, maybe atheists themselves can, you know, understand that not everyone thinks that way, and there are other people who do it, you know, without the higher power aspect of it.
This is a big topic, so that we haven't really covered as much as I kind of wish we have. So let's go ahead and take a quick break, and then we'll be back and delve more into the whole recovery type thing. Atheist Nomads is proudly brought to you by Archway Hosting. Check out their low-price, full-featured hosting solutions at archwayhosting.com. That's A-R-C-H-W-A-Y hosting.com.
Hey, we're also brought to you by listeners just like you. Find out how you can become a patron at patreon.com/atheistnomads. That's patreon.com/atheistnomads.
Okay, so with the whole 12-step thing, and what it comes down to is just people trying to recover from issues like addictions. And you definitely did bring up a really good point about how much religion creeps into it. It's based on, like, what is it, like 4 or 5 of the 12 steps require some kind of a at least pseudo-religious element to it.
So all right, yeah.
What are the actual, you know, is it actually effective? Would be, I guess, a good first question.
It's really hard to measure. You have immense problems with selection bias of people who go to 12-step groups versus those who don't. You know, the people who never show up there, nobody knows how many that is. How many people go once or twice and don't ever come back? And then you're measuring it how, you know, is it... Mm-hmm. Is it, you know, sobriety for how long? If you have a few relapses, but, you know, keep coming back, is that effective? What would have happened had he not gone, and how do you measure that? Well, you don't. Not very easily.
Yeah.
I mean, the amount of resources to go into a study like that are just tremendous, tremendous. Suffice to say, anything... basically funded by the government tends not to have it. The truth, thank goodness, tends not to have a lot of religious aspect to it. So they don't even touch it. And that's where the big money is for big studies.
But I just took a court order.
I just took a quick glance at the
AA. Lots of court order stuff. Yes.
And
only one of them has anything to do with alcohol, you'll notice.
seven out of the 12 have a direct reference to religion or God. Or wow. Understand exactly. Him.
Now, and then you look at what is, how does the religious part of this, now the according to 12-step sources, they say that they didn't even bring, religion wasn't much a part of it, well, depending, actually, it's a precursor to 12-step groups that was the Oxford group, something, a name like that. And it was more explicitly religious, but that they tried doing it without religion, and Carl Jung, of all people, said, "Oh no, you must have some sort of spirituality in there."
Hmm.
They took it. They took it, and you know, friends of Bill, you know, the Bill took it and ran with it, and it ended up looking like this, kind of a little bit of a sort of a fundamentalist feel to it, just real American style spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that whether or not a if that story is apocryphal, it is widely shared, and B, if it is really what Carl Jung intended, I just don't know.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you're dealing with things like religion, how much of it is, I mean, you talk about fellowship in religion, mm-hmm. fellowship is critically important in staying sober if you're alcoholic. I mean, it's the people. I personally see folks who get involved in the world of people and doing things and being a part of things as doing so much better than folks who stay home. It's observational. There are actually some animal studies on that, and I'm sure somebody's been doing human studies. I'm just not familiar with them.
So what parts of it... Okay, let's go ahead and just move away from that. But with trying to get through addiction, what are the things that do help? What's the actual path to recovery?
I do think, well, let me, I am going to go back to the 12 steps because oddly enough, I think there are aspects of them that you look at and you go, wait a minute, you know, I've seen that somewhere before. It does encourage fellowship, to people getting together and making a difference in each other's lives and hang out. And I think it's the sponsorship thing where you can go call somebody, you know, I got a problem, you know, and there they will call you back and help. I think those are really critical. Heck, there's even some of those steps bear an awful lot of resemblance. They're coming out an awful lot of resemblance to the total quality management, you know, Deming's continuous improvement thing. So, you know, I look at myself, I take an inventory, I look, and then I try and get past that, and then I go take a look back at what I've done, and you keep doing it over and over again. Well, it's just quality improvement. And feedback loops and introspection. One, for whatever reason, and I don't know that I've ever heard a really good explanation for it, but it is so universal that a huge proportion of people with addictions of all types have this really, if you've been around a loved one who has it, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. The denial of it is incredible. I mean, just you can't believe how powerful that is. Oh no, I'm not alcoholic, but it's this real. It's like this huge set of defenses go up all at once. It is when they say it's a knee jerk response. You know, doctors, the knee jerk response is you tap on somebody's knee and you get a little bit of, you know, the knee kicks a little bit, but if it kicks a whole lot, there's damage somewhere in the nervous system. The message ain't getting up to the higher parts of the brain. Well, this is the same thing, except it's further up in the brain. You start even breathing about, well, you know, maybe you should look at how much you're drinking. And it's just like, wham! Oh, no. You know, you're full of it. And blah, blah, blah. And run out the door, you know, to go get a drink. it's amazing. It's also amazing you see people who hide alcohol.
Yeah.
When they're drinking. And it's bizarre. I've run into people who hide alcohol when they're alone. It's almost like, you know, you see some strange, you know, behaviors and you go, oh, look at that evolutionary adaptation. You know,
yeah.
it seems like, hey, this addiction thing is evolving in us. You know, it's like a mimetic parasite or something strange.
Stephen King talked about his alcoholism in one of his books. And he was saying that his wife accused him of drinking the Listerine. And he you know, indignantly said, of course I don't. And, you know, he's thinking in his head, I drink the Scope because it actually tastes good.
Yeah, exactly. It's not Listerine. Yes, that's it.
Wow.
That's it. So the first thing a person with an addiction has to get past is that, to not lie to themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And that is actually very tough because people will give up marriages and families sometimes before they can stop lying to themselves about it.
Damn.
Yeah. So if you, and I'll tell you, you know, that's what the interventions are all about for the 12 steppers. And quite frankly, this limit setting is what it's called in mental health, where you're saying, you know, this is what's going on. I realize you don't agree, but this is what's going on. And no, I'm not going to treat you with Valium. That ain't going to happen. You know, you need to sober up, and that's the only thing. And if you don't, this is what's going to happen to you. And so that's called it. And until they can actually hear it, nothing happens. Basic
intervention.
Yeah, it's like it's just yeah. Trouble is again, depending on how you define success, interventions aren't particularly effective, or if they are, they're only briefly effective, or they're effective in making somebody go get some sort of first step toward, mm-hmm. you know, a doctor, a counselor, a 12-step group. And then they, you know, beyond that, probably not so effective. Relapse is the norm with addictions.
Okay.
Unfortunately.
Yeah.
Now here's the other thing is for the vast majority of the people where normal use, normal, you know, real people go out and get drunk, I've noticed. That doesn't mean they're addicts. Now, you talk to some doctors and they will say, oh, absolutely, that's dysfunctional, blah, 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 blah. But when you go out and look and go, no, the vast majority of the population will drink, sometimes to excess, and that's part of being sociable. It's part mm-hmm. of dealing with people. It's damaging when it starts doing damage.
Yeah.
You know, let's get real. And just like anything, you can be a little damage or a lot of damage. And we all, you know, we're all damaged by life and nobody's perfect. What we see as clinicians almost always are at the far end of the spectrum. You know, people, the things are really starting to go bad, or we pick it up as an incidental to them coming in for something else. Oh, and how much do you drink? You know,
and how much of it would you say is really just people self-medicating actual psychological and psychiatric disorders?
That's a part of it. Anxiety. Well, you know, when they say alcohol is a social lubricant, that's exactly what that is. You know, I don't think. I think we would be in severe danger of the population dwindling if it weren't for alcohol. You know, because nobody would get laid. Yeah, because it you know, everyone's too nervous, or most people are. You know, a few alpha mm-hmm. males might go out and get all the babes, but everyone else depends on some social lubricant to make the conversations happen.
Right.
You know, at least till you get it's just life. That's what clubbing is, clubbing, isn't it? You know, yeah. When you're young. Yeah. Now the question is, can you turn it off later? And for many people, there is a huge biological, the family history. You know, if your brother and father and grandfather and aunt on your mother's side, you know, are alcoholic, you got to be real careful. And sometimes they're getting along in the world and functioning socially and trying to be like everyone else. It isn't an easy answer. And you don't know, you can't read the, you know, you don't, with no crystal ball, you can't tell if you're going to become a functioning alcoholic or not.
Okay.
You know, until you get there and go, oh, I can't stop this.
Yeah, yeah. That's definitely a good point. So,
one of those spots where you just kind of have to, like, realize, oh, it's, you know, 7 in the morning and I'm having my first drink because, you know, I need to recover from the night before.
Well, right. Oh, if I don't have that first drink at 7 in the morning, I'm going to be shaky all day long. Yeah, that's you're already into the realm of it's doing damage to your nervous system. It's yeah. It's yeah. And it quite, it's real funny. Alcohol will affect different people. Some people just have their whole systems are just cast iron. All the alcohol in the world doesn't seem to bother anything. Other people, their livers give out first. Other people get seizures and shakes and things when they try and stop. Pancreatitis, you know, you just get all kinds of weird different things. Unfortunately, by the time that stuff starts happening, you're pretty far along, and it sure gets hard to stop drinking.
Mm-hmm.
It becomes awfully necessary.
Well, you brought up the, you know, people coming in and you say, you know, I can't just give you Valium. Don't even think that's going to happen. How long does it take when an alcoholic comes in? Say it's somebody who comes in because they know they're an alcoholic. How long does it take mm-hmm. to figure out how much of the problem is the drinking and how much of it is the cause of the drinking? Or to where you can start medicating?
Sometimes you never quite figure out, you know, which came first, the chicken or the egg. It does start to become, the problems co-evolve. So by the time it gets to the doctor's office, you've got a tangled knot. It's okay. It didn't so much how to get this way. It's how are we going to untie it? The Gordian knot of the situation. Mm-hmm. Realistically, you know, there's some questions that just you just say, well, we really don't know how to answer that. You know, as advanced as things are, when people start describing their, you know, panic attacks when they were 16 and then they start drinking at 18 and went, whew, that's better. You know, you get a clear history of it. It's like, mm-hmm. okay, that's yeah. But then you got to convince them that to avoid things that cause withdrawal symptoms and try and go with treatments that don't cause immediate relief, but very slow and gradual relief.
Mm.
You know, the one of the classes of medicines that vie for the most popularly prescribed medicines in the country are the antidepressants. You know, they're right up there with the blood pressure medicines and the cholesterol medicines mm-hmm. and stomach medicines. But people, you know, people tend to talk about that a little less than maybe, you know, what they're doing for their heartburn. So you don't hear about it, but those things are incredibly commonly prescribed. And
just incredibly embarrassed about having a mental problem that need help.
Oh yes. Oh yes. And well, yeah, at least historically, can cause people more social damage to have that get up than a lot of the physical problems you might end up being diagnosed with. So people do historically have kept it quieter, and mental health records are a little more protected. It's the most private and intimate things that, you know, I mean, it's right up there with some of the OBGYN things. You just don't, you know, mm-hmm. you don't talk about flight company, but incredibly common.
Yeah.
Incredible. All these things. It was just get away from the alcoholism, which, by the way, things like alcoholism, drug addiction, the person who's going to at some point, you know, not just drink to excess here and there, but to seriously have to confront, how am I going to stop this? That may be roughly 10% of the population.
Hmm. Oh, wow.
Yeah. At some point in their life, we'll have to do that. You know, hey, you look, half and three quarters of the population go out and have a good time on Friday night. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They just try not to get a DUI when they come home. To hear, I don't know, the establishment medical institutions, when they give their pronouncements, it's, oh no, you are drinking too much. If they've redefined getting drunk as a binge, you know, five ounces of liquor is binge drinking. It's like, no, that's getting a buzz on, you know, when did this yeah. happen? It is. That's, it's just, wow. So I have a little problem with that part of the establishment that likes to over pathologize things. Yeah, you can't, because you're not actually doing anyone any favors by over-pathologizing this. Neither the people who, well, on either side of it, you know, because everyone goes, oh, that's crap, because yeah. it is. But the folks with the problem. Now, when you start looking at other illnesses, if the substances are maybe 10%, oh, you start talking anxiety disorders and mood disorders, which often come together, you know, I mean, you see, it's really common, you know, like 40% of everyone.
Let's take our second break, and then we will jump in on those, since that is another huge topic. We love hearing from our listeners. You can email us at contact@atheistnomads.com, tweet us @atheistnomads, send us a message on our Facebook page at facebook.com/atheistnomads, or better yet, call us and leave us a message at 541-203-0666. We might even play it on the show. You can also help us out by leaving us a review on iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcast directory of choice. Okay, so anxiety and depression, you said yeah. addiction's about 10% of the population.
Yep.
Anxiety and depression, you said 40%?
When you start adding it all up, yeah. You know, over the course, at some point in your life where it becomes a real significant problem, you know, it starts interfering with things. Yeah. I mean, everyone gets a little anxious or a little moody here and there, but when it becomes, it starts hanging on a life of its own, it really starts interfering, you know, it affects what you can become and what you can do. It's common. And it's, the reasons behind that, well, In psychiatry, we have a model where we talk about, it's a combination, and it's a lot of moving parts, the biological, the psychological, meaning, you know, what you grew up with, you know, were you mm-hmm. abused growing up, did your mother love you, kind of thing, and the social. You know, did your boss yell at you, or did you just get fired, or are you worried that something bad's going to happen? And we all have our stresses. We got to deal with it to one point or another. And those things start pinging off each other. And, you know, you start having like the Great Recession in 2008, an awful lot of people are coming in awfully depressed. and you well, many people I was talking to were looking at homelessness. So it all blends in together. And I'm thinking, there are a few times in your life where it gets real obvious, you know, the major transitions that people go through, you know, late high school, early college, when you have to make your way, you know, or have to make your way in the world in general, and you know, find a mate, settle down, figure out what you're going to do. Huge amounts of depression and anxiety then. Transitions into retirement also. And that's, these are the times you see suicide rates go up a lot.
So not just around Christmas time.
Not just around Christmas time. And of course, around Christmas time, you're adding seasonal affective disorder aspect. It's dark all the time. There are actually some, you know, when you, the first light of dawn, let's talk evolution here. When bright light first hits your eyes in the morning, it sets off a huge cascade that is starting in deep in your brain, sending up dopamine to your pituitary. Pituitary starts putting out things to stimulate your adrenal glands and all the other stuff going on in your system, and actually make stuff, the melanocyte stimulating hormones, so you can tan when you get out in the sun and not burn. I mean, all these weird hormonal cascades. You know, and when that starts getting blunted, because it's dark, people get more depressed. It's interesting stuff. So yeah, some people, when they get wintertime blues, you know, around Christmas time, oddly enough, shortest days of the year, real bright lights, first thing in the morning. It's really important that it's like an alarm, you know, get under them for 20, 30 minutes, and it can help. It can help.
Now, okay, so with it being so common, with 40% of the population, you're saying that is for at least having had periods of like a depressive episode, as opposed to lifelong clinical depression or anxiety.
Well, that would include the lifelong stuff too.
Right.
So at least have to, yeah. The more severe things or the lingering things are less than 40%.
Okay. Because I work in IT, but I it's for a medical laboratory, and one thing that frequently happens in labs is reevaluating what normal is. Because you have to look at the data, and your normal range is. It might go up or it might go down just based on what numbers you're seeing.
Right. Exactly.
The scary thing, you know, is normal might not be healthy.
would you please tell the people who do the complete blood counts that folks don't have as high a hematocrit as they used to? Everyone's walking in anemic. It's like, you're not anemic. Not everyone is anemic. Come on. Something's happened to the norm. They haven't changed them lately.
Yeah. I think our range is, for women, the low end is 34. And on men, 39.
Yeah. And everyone hangs out around there. I mean, just, you know, it's like, oh, come on. You know, not everyone's working on the farm all day and needs to have that hemoglobin going. We're sitting in offices. We don't need to pump that much iron around our systems.
Well, and realistically, anything over 42, all that tells you is that you're dehydrated.
Yeah.
That's not necessarily.
There are a couple things, but that's getting pretty technical. I had to rant about that. Sorry about
that. All right. So for just the situational type, when somebody has a depressive episode or a period of heightened anxiety, what are some ways to deal with that to keep it from becoming actually problematic?
Okay. Well, of course, I'm going to, you know, see your doctor. Never mind. I can't help that. It depends On if it, you know, there are the garden variety. Oh, your girlfriend, your boyfriend dumped you, you know, and that's just time. That's just, mm-hmm. you know, and obviously the first thing you can do is, and this is what people naturally do, is they go find good friends and confide in them, or, you know, hang out, and, you know, people gather around and support each other in those circumstances. And folks get through it, but, for, you're kind of defining, you're saying this is on the more normal end of the spectrum. Mm-hmm. It is all the things now we're talking, these are all the things that they tell you to do on Oprah, and that your mother told you to do when you were growing up, and, you know, go out and get exercise and get out there, other, you know, they're more efficient to see, work harder, overcome the obstacles. And in fact, that is totally normal to a point. And after which, if you're starting to get into now the sort of things you actually will go to a psychiatrist to see, or even your family practitioner, it's getting bad enough. You really are going, I need to get some help here. Telling somebody to overcome it, you know, this will pass, is can be damaging. It's
heard that's like the worst advice of a person.
Yeah, yeah. Well, major depression is no longer, you know, your girlfriend dumped you and this will pass. It is an illness. And we have the illusion of free will. Mm-hmm. I wish we had more actual free will. There's the addiction thing. And then you look at how depression lies to you, and you know, there's no reason you can't, you know, get up and do all the things you need to do, except you simply cannot. You know, and everyone goes, well, why are you just lying there? Well, he's depressed. He's ill. Something is wrong with the machinery.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's when it gets like that, that's when you go to the doctor. There are psychotherapies. Psychotherapy really, really works. Mm-hmm. In fact, if anything is more likely to be a cure meaning you do something or take a treatment for a distinct period of time. You stop the treatment, then you never have the problem again. The psychotherapy is much more likely to get you where you want to get as a cure than the medicines.
Right.
The medicines, you know, they provide symptomatic relief. You know, you take, while you take the medicines, they're going to do what they do, but you stop them, whatever's underneath there is, may come right back.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it's like with Lauren, with her depression, when something's wrong, telling her, I just got to deal with it, isn't going to help, because it's, in her case, medical. Telling her, you know, it's time to give your doctor a call, that actually can help.
Absolutely. It's absolutely. It really, because you take somebody who's grappling with these can be profound feelings of hopelessness, and you say, you know, overcome it, it's not going to help. Mm-hmm. It makes the feelings of hopelessness worse on average, or it makes them hurt and angry, it's not constructive
too. I mean, like, why can't I get over this? I must be defective.
Yes, that's one of the, now when you talk depression, there are some real characteristic symptoms. They're actually kind of physical symptoms, but they we call them neurovegetative. And one of them is pathological guilt. You know, I there's something horribly wrong with me. I can't do this stuff. I can't, you know, get up and over the hump and make things happen. And it's my fault. I'm not doing the stuff I need to. And some of them are more clearly physical. Insomnia problems, whether it's trouble getting sleep, or is often the case, waking up early in the morning and just can't go back to sleep, you know, feeling like they're feeling terrible.
Are you appetite changes? Some of those overachievers that like wake up so early in the morning might actually be depressed?
No. Oh, well, no, not all waking up early is depression. Not all, it's not all neurovegetative symptoms. Matter of fact, heck, that can be totally normal. It can even be the opposite, a mania, which is like there's depression, there's normal, and then there's mania, which is no need to sleep, you know. I'm doing great. I've got lots of energy. No, it's an illness, but it's not depression. So, yeah, no, you can have all kinds of reasons not to sleep. One of them can be depression. Appetite changes. You can have all kinds of reasons to have an increased or decreased appetite. One of those reasons is depression. Inability to concentrate. Probably the first thing they taught us in medical school is when a patient walks in your door and says, he was talking to future primary care doctors, you know, when your patient walks in the door and says, "Doc, I have Alzheimer's, you know, I can't concentrate at all," they probably do not have Alzheimer's. Depression is even called pseudo-dementia of depression. It looks a little like Alzheimer's, you know, they're just scattered. Mm-hmm. It's not, it's depression. Treat the depression, it tends to get better. Yeah, of course, the low energy, depressed people just can't get moving. In severe depression, now mind you, not everyone with depression gets all of these things, but it is kind of it's a Chinese menu, you know, 5 of 9, and you have, you know, what we doctors call depression. A lack of ability to feel pleasure in things. Is it 100% profound and total? Usually not. If it's 100% profound and total, the person might need to be hospitalized because things are going badly quickly. Mm-hmm. These things happen often enough, and it can be set off by something, you know, by a stressor, or come out of the blue. You see, God, when it comes out of the blue, a lot of time, you know, you have family members. Oh yeah, a lot of family members have this problem. It's like, okay. And then other people, it takes more and more of a stressor to bring these things on. But at some point, people fall into a state where it takes on a life of its own. You know, you name that demon, you know, you start seeing these things, it's like, yeah, major depression.
Damn. Yeah. So, at what point would you say somebody who has never gotten treatment before, at what point should they get help, and what should be the first stop, or who should be the first stop?
I would, if you think you need help, that's a good idea. And if somebody else thinks you need help who knows you well, it's a good idea. And realistically, you go in whatever path works easiest for you. Probably the most common way to do it is actually through your family doctor. That is one of their jobs, is to get things started with treatment. Some of them are even trained in a little bit of psychotherapy, and you know, and then they will typically. They may bring you back. They may manage it all themselves. As a matter of fact, a lot of the more garden variety common things they do. And in fact, you know, by the time he gets to a psychiatrist, you know, we don't get the easy cases because the family doctors are all helping those people.
Mm-hmm. A GP can also find out if it's something very simple and medical, like a hypoactive thyroid. Yes. Or
exactly that's a standard workup. You check the thyroid, a couple of, not every vitamin level, if you've got a problem with it, will lead to depression, but if your B12 level or folate level, I mean, the first symptom of those problems is depression, you know, and then you start getting profound physical problems. But I pick that stuff up all the time because you're coming in depressed. It's actually kind of nice. Somebody seriously ill, seriously depressed, has to be hospitalized, worried about, you know, thinking suicide, things like that. And, oh, you have a low B12. You fix that, and they go tap dancing out. It's like, yay. That was easy, you know. Because, yeah, so it can be, you know, or thyroid. Of course, thyroid, low thyroid, people slow down and get depressed. High thyroid, they're climbing up the walls, anxious, you know, sometimes out of touch with reality if it gets real bad. Mm-hmm.
Testosterone, of course, psychotic. Is another big one that can do that.
Yeah. Well, it's a little controversial, and it will probably always be a little controversial, but yes. Clearly, the sex hormones for men and women affect mood a lot. You know, obviously, when women start complaining of the premenstrual dysphoria, PMS, those are the hormonal fluxes that are probably going on there.
So if you got a guy that's taking a lot of Rogaine, you might want to, and he's having depressive symptoms, you might want to ask him to get off of that for a while.
The minoxidil?
Yeah.
I'd have to look up the. Yeah, I'm sorry. Rogaine being that's a hair treatment that actually. For these days for hair, that you rub it into your scalp and it helps grow it. It started off as a blood pressure medicine. People take it and they get hairy all over. You know.
Huh. I believe that's the same for the little blue pill too.
Yeah, that's right. They were investigating mm-hmm. it for blood pressure, you know, and then discovered an interesting side effect. Yeah,
there's so many awesome off-label uses that eventually get approved and make millions mm-hmm. or billions.
Exactly. In fact, once it is in generic, like there's some things that we're in mental health we work with that were discovered on a medicine that went generic. Many years before, nobody's going to pay the FDA the amount of money it takes to get it officially approved for off-label. But heck, half of what the psychiatrists use these days are off-label for a lot of stuff that started off as blood pressure medicines and thyroid and things like that. Yeah.
Hmm. Awesome. I personally love the off-label stuff. Especially when you start looking into how is that working, and when there's a really good mm-hmm. Methodological explanation for it, then it's just, oh, that's just, it's so cool.
Exactly.
One of my favorite examples of that is IVIG getting used to treat autoimmune disorders. It was created to help boost people's immune systems who can't produce antibodies. Well, it also works mm-hmm. that if your body produces bad antibodies against yourself, autoantibodies, that by pumping your body full of somebody else's antibodies, it shuts down your own antibody production, and then you don't have autoantibodies anymore. And it's just awesome.
Yes. Love when a plan comes together like that.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Hannibal. If you like the show, consider giving us some financial support. To make it really easy with one-time donations, or to support us on a per episode, monthly, or even annual basis using PayPal or Patreon, find out more at atheistnomads.com. Use the links on the right side of the page. $1 an episode is all we ask. Please, think of the kittens.
I really wanted to know about atheists and depression. How do their numbers compare, do you think, versus religious people? Do you think that atheists are more likely to be depressed, or is it about the same that you've heard? Or?
I think that I would. Okay. First, I don't know for a fact the answer to that question. Okay. That won't stop me from pontificating on it.
Excellent.
I really think we are no more likely to get depressed than other people in our demographic. I mean, if you really look at it, atheists on average are on average, obviously not everyone, more white collar, academic, and probably fairly uniformly, some of those higher IQ. Understand we're talking trends here, mm-hmm. but I think it track more with those demographics.
Education and religiosity have a inverse correlation.
I've always heard that the dumber the person, the happier they are, and Republicans are sure dumb.
Well, we have to think about the problems in realistic ways and try and, there is something to be said for denial.
Is bliss.
Yes, denial as a defense mechanism. It works. Yeah. Well, those of us who are really thinking about, looking at the world as it is actually happening, I think a key to happiness is to deal with the world as it is, but to a point, dealing with the world as it is not can be pretty groovy too, right up until it slaps you in the face. Mm-hmm.
Well,
and those of us who are in the reality-based communities are trying to prevent it from slapping you in the face,
Mm-hmm. Well, and a couple big benefits, bringing up things that you've already mentioned, that religious people have, especially those who are active in their religion, is you have a community. people you are regularly meeting with. You have a social safety net right there with that. And even if they forsake you, you still have your imaginary friend.
Yes.
So you're never alone.
That is true. That is true. Where things become existential thinking, you know, Jean-Paul Sartre and things, it sure sounds pretty depressing, but I don't know. I think we can look at things and go, well, yeah, we may not, you know, everyone knows we're going to die and everything, but heck, this is a pretty good ride.
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely. I definitely think that atheists have a lot of definite advantages there, areas like that.
It's always surprised me how much religious people cry at funerals versus atheists, or at least the ones that I've seen. Religious people are just losing their shit. And I think they somewhere in the back of their mind, they know that the shit's false, but that's just me.
Yeah, they have to defend against it, too. The people who are proclaiming God the loudest, mm-hmm. may have the most doubts. Well, it's like when you see all the anti-homosexual legislators who get caught, you know, in scandals. Mm-hmm. It goes with the denial and that strange knee-jerk response to things. It's like, whoa, that's not normal. That's there's something cut off there. The frontal lobes ain't talking to the rest of the brain, you know.
Well, and I've also found, observing it with my own family, is that the same thing with those of us who aren't religious, and especially atheists, grieve faster. And it's hard to be in denial if the person is dead. And you have a reality-based worldview, and there is no one to bargain with. And if you cut out those two steps, it's a little harder to drag it out so long.
Yeah, that's true. Now, I'm trying to think of the... There's some complexities you can add in there. It's not... When things are otherwise, all else being equal, I totally agree with you. Now, if you actually have a biological disposition to depression, mm-hmm. You know, that might be different.
Oh, yeah.
But for otherwise, you know, all the equipment working right, and I think it's pretty groovy being atheist.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just don't like superstition, organized or otherwise.
Yeah. And okay, not to keep it on the morbid area, but like when somebody dies, I find it almost poetic if it's somebody who's lived a good life and they have a final the end, as opposed to a to be continued at the end.
Yes.
There are movies that do not need a sequel.
most of them.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, the whole thing that this is just a trial run, and you know, that just upsets me to no end.
Well, it is a trial run, but it's somebody else who gets to do the next run. You know? It's not, you know.
You know, this life that we have is so final, so far as I can tell. And I'm going to make the best out of it. And, you know, when somebody's like, oh, you know, I'm going to ride to heaven on a horse with wings and then, you know, have my life eternal with God. I'm like, really, how much more stuff could you do or live a better life if you just lived in the moment a little bit?
Yeah. You know, there's among psychotherapists, it's a truism. You're talking about the grieving process and whether mm-hmm. it goes smoothly or is rough and prolonged and difficult. People who have a lot of, say anger at a loved one, a spouse, a parent or something like that, versus somebody who had a real good relationship, you know, when the other person dies, which person do you think is going to have an easier time of it?
The one that loved them.
Yeah, the one that had a great relationship tend to have a much easier grieving process. The folks who there's a lot of anger.
I had a shit grieving period with my mom. So, yeah, you can tell which one I was.
Oh, dear. Yep.
Yeah.
I still have issues, and she died in 07.
Yeah, with my nephew, the last time I spoke with him was not a very good conversation, and I believe I yelled at him. Last time I saw him, I yelled at him, and then had to say no when he called me several months later, and it left me with a lot of guilt. I reached acceptance that he had died, but yeah, there was still a lot of guilt there for quite a while. Whereas it would have been a lot easier if everything had been good.
Right. You know, and for something that is invisible, it sure does make a difference. I mean, that kind of stress, you know, you don't see it. There's nothing you can tap on and go, yeah, that's real. It's just the conversation you had, right? You know, it makes a huge difference.
Yeah. And you can't make things right when somebody's dead.
Yeah.
All right, well,
that led to a moment of silence.
Yeah. editing.
Man.
Yeah. Well, we got all kinds of theories of of psychology and depression and things having all wrapped up in that. It's amazing. Which that was stuff Freud was doing. I think Freud got a whole lot right. The trouble is it was before you could really apply the scientific method, so it was all analog.
Mm-hmm.
He got a lot wrong, but he got an impressive amount right. You just have to take it, you know, as analog, analogy.
Mm-hmm.
There isn't actually a little guy called the id sitting on your shoulder saying, do it, you know.
All right. Well, this is, man, I really don't want to leave it on a downer like this. we are about out of time. Fuck, we gotta turn this around real quick.
Okay.
Yeah, so back to the, atheists do have it good.
Yes. Yes, we do. I think it pays to deal with the world as it is.
Mm-hmm.
The world's a better place, and we are better for it. And I'm all about getting it right.
I would rather live in a reality-based world than a whole bunch of fairy tales.
Yeah, when I mentioned my uncle was a psychiatrist. One of the things, you know, a piece of advice when I was growing up was that if you can see the world as it actually is and deal with it on that level, what is neurosis, but having some mismatch between your map of the world and the way it really is. And so, you know, those of us mm-hmm. who work hard to get the map right and then act on it, you know, based on the real roadmap, and that'll get us where we want to go.
Yeah.
And,
you know, and when that doesn't quite work out, fortunately, there are psychiatrists with really awesome drugs.
Yay.
Living 100 years ago with depression would have really sucked compared to now.
Yeah. And there were, well, you know, you get people like Abraham Lincoln who did so much for us. He did it depressed, you know, Winston Churchill, mm-hmm. all those things. The antidepressants were invented after World War II. All you had before then was, you know, opium and alcohol.
Yeah. And Churchill, they actually scheduled World War II planning sessions around his mood swings.
Wow. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Which was really rough on his staff because that would usually mean working straight through for 72 hours.
Oh, wow. That almost sounds bipolar, you know?
The biography I read in college suggested that he was bipolar.
Yeah, that's the kind of thing.
The general cycles, they'd have a good week where they could actually get some work done. And then everybody would leave him alone for a week while they actually executed it, and he slept.
Really? Yeah. Yeah, because I will tell you, you know, a bipolar disorder can look like depression. It looked just like depression. As a matter of fact, it can fool professionals. But it's a different animal. It really is. People get manicky. Treated differently, biologically, something different going on.
Mm-hmm.
It's a whole different animal.
Well, I would suspect if all you're doing is trying to boost somebody's mood and they're going into a manic phase, that's not going to mix well.
Right. Right. The traditional antidepressants just speed up the cycling. They don't actually.
Oh.
Their moods flake out. You can't predict what's going to happen next.
Oh.
So, yeah. And if a person, you know, people can have bipolar disorder but never showed anything but depression. And even the professionals will put them on an antidepressant and then wonder why it doesn't work, or, oh gosh, they just took off like a skyrocket. What happened there? You know? Whoops. Come back. You know, we got a different medicine for you. You
know? Oh man. Well, until we have like brain scans or some kind of a chemical test.
My life's goal is to invent the electropsychogram, you know? Put you in the machine, have it make some, you know, noise that goes ping or something, and read it and say, oh yeah, here you go. There it is right there. You can see that little squiggle. That means mm-hmm. you've got bipolar disorder. Yeah. I haven't done it yet. I'll get around to it someday.
Yeah, I think there might actually be a chance with where, like, fMRI and some of that imaging is going.
Oh yeah.
But
that is true, and some lab tests. Mm-hmm. They're looking at doing some genetic analyses, and there are starting to be. I think it's about 10 years ago they're starting to talk about, okay, if you have this allele to that, you know, that dopamine receptor or norepinephrine receptor, that you're going to do much better on this drug as opposed to that drug. It's gotten stuck somewhere between, you know, the bench scientists doing the studies and actual, you know, people coming into the doctor's office and getting that same test and getting on the medicine. They're working. It's starting to happen.
From what I've seen, it's the science is a little bit too weak to get insurance to pay for it.
There you go. And same, some of the, well, the fMRIs are just, they're the science is too hard to actually get the scans. You can't mm-hmm. run everyone through the, you know, through them spec studies. There's a doctor here in Tacoma doing spec studies and treating people, and it is science. He's probably stretching it a little far. I don't want to go into it too much, but yeah, there are doctors out there, and I believe some of what he's doing is probably legit, but the science
mm-hmm.
proving it is not quite there yet. So people pay out of pocket for it, you know, to get these scans and things. Give it enough time and it'll get there. It does get there eventually. Well, for a while, when I first got into medical school, there's a test we could do to see if somebody had biological depression that would be amenable to treatment with the standard antidepressants. And all well and good, except it was neither sensitive nor specific enough. There are too many false negatives and positives in the test. So it was almost, you might as well flip a coin, you know, whether it actually told you what you needed to know or not. So it stopped being done pretty quickly, you know. But bit by bit, we got some techniques we didn't have back in the day. We're working on it. Well, and the meds are a lot better. Man, yeah. The side effects are so much better.
And if you look at the turn of the last century, there was three or four different competing schools of thought on how medicine should work. One finally won out as the science finally caught up with people's ideas. And that's where we got medicine. This next generation of medicine, or maybe it'd be the third or fourth generation, whatever you want to call it, it's going to take time for the science to, and the data to actually catch up with these ideas and find out what actually works. And then it's going to take some time to get it to the point where it's actually cheap enough to do for people.
Exactly. I'm looking forward to the what they call Affymetrics, a company that does genetic things where they can just run. It looks like in the very near future, they're going to be able to run massive amounts of, if it has anything to do with DNA, they'll be able to tell it in vast numbers of studies, labs all at once for nothing, very little money. With just basically, if you that piece of DNA floating around in your system somewhere, whether it's from you or some bacteria or something, it will know it. You know, awesome. It's pretty cool on the cheap, and it's done with like microlithography, like doing computer chips. And the DNA, you get the right DNA thing, and it completes a circuit, and lights up. It's like they can do 10,000 different things at once.
Oh, where I think it's all going to be going here pretty soon is you need to do blood work. Okay, drop a blood from a finger stick onto a sensor that's on a mobile phone and need some body imaging, just do it from the mobile device or something built into the wall in the doctor's office.
Yeah, that's called a tricorder.
It will happen.
They've been...
Oh, yeah. We are very close. It won't look quite like the ones in Star Trek because there actually will be physical contact required on a lot of it, but we are getting close. And it's going to put a lot of labs and imaging companies out of business.
I believe they've been having an X Prize for a tricorder like device for last 10, 15 years, and they're actually getting some really good entries.
Mm-hmm.
Huh. At one point there was talk of doing an EEG scan, except instead of you have to get right up on the scalp to read the brain waves. But if you do it with magnetic waves, it can be done from much more distance. And it was kind of spooky stuff. I think certain three-letter agencies might have been interested in some of that, but I never did hear what happened with it.
Wow. Yeah. A lot of it for me, I just hope that the regulations can actually keep up with the technology, because there's only so much you actually want people without a medical license to have access to.
Yeah. Yeah. And or make sure it as things get proven safe, that it be able to get to the more over-the-counter market, you know?
Yeah.
Well, the FDA manages that by just slowing everything down, you know?
Oh, yeah. So if the tech is 20 years away, then the FDA will make it 40.
Yeah. There is something called transcranial magnetic stimulation, where they literally will put the super magnet up against your head. It's a little like electroconvulsive therapy, where they zap you with electricity and you have a seizure, and it cures your depression or treats it, and except it does it with magnetism. It doesn't induce a seizure, but it's as far as we know, the same idea, except it doesn't zap your whole brain. You can kind of pick the spot you want to do. And it was when I was in residency in the late 1980s, they were like, oh yeah, this is coming. It's hot. Everyone's looking at it. It's great. And it was 2007 or 8 before, it was 20 years after that before it ever got approved.
Damn.
Yeah. And it's real expensive. The meds are so much cheaper. You know, Walmart will get you a prescription of Prozac for $4 a month.
Yeah. All right. What do you have? Do you have anything to plug?
Well, no. Actually, I don't have a book I just wrote. I'm just here to talk about mental health and atheism, and hope I can be a help to people.
Okay, we are out of time. Actually, a bit over the normal time frame. So, thank you very much for joining us.
Definitely.
Thank you. I enjoyed
it. It was definitely awesome meeting you in person down there in Tacoma,
too. Yes, it was.
And you come back anytime. Maybe I can go visit you guys.
Sweet.
As well.
Wesley will be easier for you to visit. He's in Bremerton.
Yes.
I'm in Boise.
You know, there's some really nice breweries up in Paulsbo. We can, you know, have a binge drinking session.
And with some of those breweries, it's one beer would be counted as a binge.
It's just about, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'll walk you over and show you the good Belgians.
Yeah.
And also do want to remind all of you, if you have any money to spare, go to GoFundMe. The link is in the show notes to help out Jolene, so her parents can actually pay for the treatments to take care of this little girl's eye cancer, because that's just really shitty. Yeah. And everything would help so that they can actually pay the bills. In 4 days' time, they've already raised $1,742. I would definitely like to see this number go way up. And it'd mean a lot to them and us as well if you do.
Hey, if you donate a good chunk of money to them, please let us know. If you donate any, let us know. Give you a shout out
too. Yes, definitely. Send us a screenshot from GoFundMe, and we will give you quite the shout out, or just an email saying you did.
Yeah.
We could also try a scathing atheist style challenge on that, promising to see. Theirs was insulting anybody you want. I don't know if that's quite our forte, but
I could probably do that.
You got somebody in mind?
I can do just about anybody but Christopher Hitchens. He's
Oh, I can do Hitchens. We can do everyone then.
There we go. I would love to go after Mother Teresa. Just saying.
All right. Anyway, if you have a special request of us and you donate money to help out Jolene, you can go ahead and email that request to us. And if not, just let us know that you donated, and we will give you a shout out on the show with our thanks. And Tom, thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, thank you for having me on.
And for our listeners, we'll be... go ahead.
If you'd like to donate to the show and have me do the show nude, you have to donate at least $200, and I will do that. Likewise, if you would like me to not do the show nude...
Yeah, that's
again,
I'm in for that $100. One.
Okay, if it's $100 for Wesley to be nude... anybody who matches that, and by matches I mean $1 will be enough to match it, I will happen to lose the video.
Yeah.
All right, we'll be back next week with news.
Thank you for listening to another episode of Atheist Nomads. You can find show notes and contact information at atheistnomads.com. Follow us on Twitter at Atheist Nomads, and like us on Facebook at facebook.com/atheistnomads. Please subscribe to the show in iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcatcher of choice, and while you're there, feel free to leave us a review. Theme music is courtesy of Sturdy Fred. Until next time, this has been the Atheist Nomads.